There are a lot of ways to improve your workflow process in Final Cut Pro, so let's look at some of the pros of using presets in your workflow. Ready, preset, go! If you're still here despite that intro, thank you. And more importantly, if you're somebody who uses Final Cut Pro regularly but you're not using presets, I can pretty much guarantee that you're adding in a lot of extra time and work to your workflow. So let's work on getting rid of that and streamlining some stuff. We're gonna jump in and talk about how to create and use presets. Then I will show you how to organize and share presets. And then we can even talk about the difference between a preset and a LUT, because even though they kind of seem like they do the same thing, there is actually a LUT that sets them apart. So I've created a sample timeline in Final Cut Pro with a couple of clips that I have not adjusted yet. If you're not familiar with presets, to get to them, you just go to the effects window, the effects palette thingy, and click that and it will open up. I've created a custom category and that's where all of my presets live. And I create presets for lots of different things. And just like with any effect or anything, you can click on a clip and then mouse over your preset to see how it would look applied to that clip. So you can see all these different things. Like I've even made this picture-in-picture preset right here. So since most of my videos are filmed with the same equipment, the same lighting, and the same environment, it's pretty easy to just have created one preset that I really like and then apply that to all my footage and I'm ready to go. Now, what you don't want to do is start going through your clip and then editing it and adjusting it, because now I've turned that one clip into four or five different clips, and any adjustments I make, I'm gonna have to go through and make to all those different clips or create a new preset to add to that. So to just make things simpler, before I start any cutting in my editing, that's where I'm going to add in my preset. So this clip that you're looking at right now is from the Sony a7S III, and this is just with the default picture profile. There's nothing fancy happening here. It's not S-Log, it's just straight out of the camera, and it actually looks pretty decent. I really do like the way that Sony cameras handle blues and greens, and since my environment is predominantly blue, it really blew me away how good it looked when I added this preset. And I've got this preset right here called Main One, and that is my main one that I use for all of my videos. So I just drag that on top of this footage. I could also just double click on the preset to add it. And now you can see quite a difference. If I undo it, that's what it looked like before everything was added. And if I redo it, that's what it looked like afterwards. And you might have noticed that before I added the preset, there were these black bars on the left and right of the screen, and that's because the camera records in a 16:9 aspect ratio, but I upload and publish my YouTube videos in a 2:1 aspect ratio, which is just a little narrower and a little bit wider. And I like that because it fits mobile devices a little bit better. And I also just personally like the framing of that aspect ratio more. So then when I add the preset, those black bars go away and the clip fills the entire frame. If you want to know how to do the 2:1 aspect ratio, I did do an entire video all about that. It's a pretty simple process and I really like it. I've been doing it for like a year and a half or more at this point. The only thing I need to adjust, since I really like the way these colors look, is the framing, because my head and my hair is getting cut off here. So I can just click on the video settings and adjust the Y axis right there. And I usually just bring it down so that the top of my head or my hair is just below the top of the frame. And that's it. And now I can go through and cut up this clip and edit it the same way I would any normal clip. I have applied that preset. So what's included in the preset that I have put together is a color board adjustment that plays with the exposure. There's also a color wheels adjustment that plays with some of the saturation and some of the coloring. And then there's also this 114% crop. So that's what pushes it in and makes it fill the hole frame in the wider aspect ratio. And what's really cool is when you make a preset, all of these different settings, your color grading, your color correction, your transformation, cropping, distorting, anything that you add, it can get included into a preset. And the preset that I'm using right now was actually made for my Canon EOS R, which was my main camera for a really long time until I got the Sony a7S III. And just to experiment, I just took the R's preset and threw it on the Sony footage, and I actually really liked the way that it looked. So here's the Sony footage with the preset on it, and here is EOS R footage just straight out of the camera with no preset applied. It's kind of the same thing. It's a little bit darker. It's not framed properly, so I'm gonna add that same preset to it. Do the same thing I did with the Sony footage and adjust the framing on the Y-axis. And now I've got these two clips. But as you might know, Sony and Canon process their colors differently. Sony tends to lean a little more towards the greens and Canon leans a little more towards the magentas. Neither is better or worse, they're just different. I have found though that it's very, very easy to match the two camera systems together, despite what you might have heard. So don't be scared to make Sony and Canon cameras if that's something you've been hesitating. So what I've been doing, since I actually prefer the Sony footage, it's a little cooler, it handles the blues better, and I think the skin looks a little more natural. So I go into the Canon footage, go to color wheels, because even though I've added a preset, I can still adjust it and modify it. And then I go to tint and do a -6. And what that -6 does is it shifts the Canon footage just a little more towards the green. And now you can see here's the Canon footage and here's the Sony footage. They match up pretty well. I know it's not perfect. I'm not a professional colorist, but for me, I think this looks fine. So now I've got both clips ready to go, and that's basically how you use presets. Let's talk about how to create a preset. So this one that I'm using for the Sony in my main shot, I like it. I don't need to do anything with that. But now that it's been a couple of months with the Sony, and every time I use it, I have to go in and add in these corrections to the Canon to bump it over to match the Sony, I'm just going to make a new preset here. And the way I do that is I've got all my adjustments, and I just click Save Effects Preset. It doesn't matter that I'm saving a new preset based on an existing preset. It makes no difference. So here I'm gonna call it not effects preset, I'm gonna call it EOS R main, because it's my main preset for the EOS R. And it's gonna go in the custom category. If you've never made a preset before, you're not gonna have a custom category. You're just gonna have all the standard ones. So you just go to the bottom, click new category, and then you can create and name a category whatever you want. I like custom because you can't spell custom without Tom. And then you can include different effects. But one thing right now, I don't want to include the positioning. That's that Y axis, because that changes every time depending on how I, you know, frame the camera. So there's no point in including that. Scale, I'm going to include since I publish everything in 2:1. But if I wanted to make a preset to use in a, you know, 16:9 normal video, I would just uncheck the scale thing and then I won't use that. And that's it. And then I click Save, and now already it's showing up the EOS R main preset is there, and that's how you create brand new presets. It is super simple, and the same thing is true for audio as well in Final Cut Pro. So if I scroll down in the effects and I go into the audio setting, you can see I've done the same thing, custom audio, and I have a few presets that I've made there, and it works the exact same way. You can go through your video, you can adjust your audio, and when you're done, you just go into the audio tab and save the effects preset. And it works the exact same way. So if you're doing something like where you use the same microphone regularly and you know what adjustments you need to make it sound its best, you can create a preset for that. If you're doing a video podcast where you and your host or your co-host, you have, you know, different microphones and different voice sounds and you dial it into what sounds good, you can make a preset for each of you. And then every time you have a new episode, you just drag on those presets and you're done. You don't have to start from scratch each time. So it can be a huge time saver if you have a workflow like mine where you're doing similar style videos with the same equipment and setup over and over again. But presets are also a great time saver even if you're just doing a one-off project, like you're doing a client project and you've got the audio for that project dialed in or the coloring for that project. Create a preset and use it for that project even if you'll never use it again, because it's super easy to organize your presets so that way your window over here doesn't get just overloaded with different presets and stuff. So now let's look at how to organize your presets, and the first thing you're gonna need to do is figure out where they are stored on your computer. There's a few different ways to do this, but the simplest one is to just right click on any preset and select Reveal in Finder. And that's gonna bring up the directory where all of your Final Cut presets are stored, and you can just play with them right here. So for example, this pip preset that I made, it's a picture-in-picture preset for another video I worked on. I'm never gonna use that again, not because I won't use a picture-in-picture effect, but because that was so specific for the framing of that video, I'm never gonna use it again, so I'm going to delete it. And that way it's not gonna be taking up space in my preset. High pitch removal is an audio preset I made, but that's again for a video where that was a very specific setting, so I'm gonna delete that. Main one, this is the main preset that I've been using. Now, since I'm using different cameras and things, I'm gonna call this the A7S3 main. So I renamed my preset there, and then I've got EOS R main. S-Log Canon 50, I don't need to play with that. I was trying to learn how to color grade S-Log. And if I go back into Final Cut Pro, in real time, it has already changed those things. So now there's only presets in here. There's A7S III main, blue border. That's when I have like a picture-in-picture thing and I just wanna have the window have a blue border around it, and my EOS R main preset. So it's very easy to keep things clean and organized, which is really important for your workflow. But also, it becomes very easy to then share presets. So this A7S III main one, I'm gonna duplicate that, and I'll just rename this Tom Buck FCP preset. I should make a whole bunch of these videos about presets and put them all in one place where you can learn about them at the same time, and I could call it preschool. All right. So the reason I did that is so I can take this preset, which is a duplicate of the main one that I use, and I'm gonna put this as a downloadable link in the description to this video, totally for free, but just so you can experiment with it if you want. It probably won't look amazing on your setup because it's dialed in for my specific setup, but I'll also include like the camera settings and stuff that I use. So if you wanna try to match it, you can, but at least it gives you an idea of how easy it is to share presets and stuff like that. So now you can see using presets, creating them and organizing them, even sharing them is an actually really simple process, and I love that. The last thing to talk about is what the heck then is the difference between a preset and a LUT, because on the surface, they kind of seem to do the same thing. You have a preset, you add it to your footage, and it changes the way that it looks based on some pre-designated settings. If you have a LUT, you add it to your footage, and it changes the way that it looks based on some pre-designated settings. What is the difference? And the simplest way to think about it is that a preset is program specific. So my Final Cut preset is not gonna work in Premiere, it's not gonna work in Resolve or anything like that, but it also gives you a lot more flexibility to go in and dial things around. Once I've added the preset, I can still go in and see everything that it did. So just like I added it to the Canon EOS R footage, I can go into the color wheels and still change everything. If I need to modify it, I can have granular control over everything. I could decide that I didn't want the crop and take that off. You can break down all the separate components of the preset. A LUT, on the other hand, is a LUT different because it is sort of just a one and gun thing. Like everything is baked in. You can adjust the intensity of the LUT, but you can't open it up, at least as far as I know, and look at all the individual things. However, you can use a LUT on a lot of different programs, basically anything, Final Cut, Premiere, Resolve, anything else. You can even use LUTs in Ecamm Live. So here's my preview window in Ecamm that I'm using to just monitor the recording of this video. And you can see down here, I actually do have a LUT based on the same preset that I made right here. And that's the footage straight out of the camera. But if I want to record or stream through Ecamm, I can just add a LUT and go right there. Now, that's all I can do though, is just turn the LUT on and off or adjust the intensity of it. I can't then open it up and go play with all those different settings. And that's the biggest difference. If you want to know how to create your own LUTs, I did make a video all about creating LUTs for Ecamm Live, so you can check that out. Even if you're not using the LUT with Ecamm, it still walks you through the process of creating LUTs, which again can be used with any other program or, you know, shared very easily online and stuff like that. This is one of those videos where I'm hoping you can learn from my mistake, because I didn't really start using Final Cut Pro presets until about a year ago, but I've been using Final Cut Pro pretty much exclusively for like 9 years or 10 years, and I don't know why it took me so long to get on the preset bandwagon. So if you're using Final Cut Pro, trust me, presets will make your life a lot easier. Don't forget, you can download for free my main preset that I used here. I don't know if that's actually gonna be super helpful or not, but at least you could poke around with it. And if you want to learn more about Final Cut Pro, because this really just scratches the surface of it, it's an incredibly powerful program. I have an entire playlist of Final Cut Pro videos so that you can become the Final Cut Pro. Yo.